You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Welcome to the CSUDH Young Scholars Program. Welcome to Health 100, Health and Lifestyles. This is Dr. Matthew Ting, your instructor for the course. And today is our session number 6, and we will talk about ethics and everything around ethics in health and the healthcare and our lifestyles. So something like ethics is everywhere, and people may have different definitions. As the textbook, the chapter 5, says right off the bat, says, in recent years, there has been an increasing interest in ethical questions in all walks of life. So ethics is not just applicable to certain areas of our life, but rather it is everywhere. I just got a new car, my second electric vehicle, and this morning the dealership called me asking right off the bat a number of questions, whether I'm happy with my new car or not. And the first question they asked me, whether the salesperson treated me professionally and ethically. So I was thinking, that's quite interesting, because I was going to teach the class this afternoon about ethics. So you can see that ethics is applicable to many parts of our lives. However, the awareness is not always like at our level today in the history of the United States. And in healthcare field, there was something very shocking, and it was quite a few years, and that's something called the Tuskegee syphilis trial or study. So today, we'll first half of the class, you will see a number of video clips, quite a few of them. The scenes may not be very comfortable, may scare you a little bit, but I want to assure you that I just kind of see what's going on as happened in the history in the US, other parts of the world. That's important for us to see that it may be scary for us. It may give us nightmares, and hopefully not, but it's by becoming aware of such things happening in the history, and some quite recent, that will prevent us from having even more nightmares, more scares down the road for ourselves, for our children, our grandchildren, and people around us, our loved ones. So let's see the first video clip about the Tuskegee syphilis study.
To the survivors, to the wives and family members, the children and the grandchildren, I say what you know. What the United States government did was shameful, and I am sorry.
The Tuskegee study of untreated syphilis in the African American male, lasting from 1932 until 1972, was a violation of the rights of a vulnerable population by irresponsible medical professionals for the sake of medical knowledge. This deception harmed patients and their families for decades. However, the backlash from this study profoundly changed modern medical research. 82% of the Macon County population is African American, many living in dirt floor shacks without plumbing. Most have never seen a doctor in their lives and are illiterate.
The Public Health Service selected Macon County for a syphilis treatment program because over a third of the residents had the infection. Patients were treated with injections of heavy metals and mercury rubs, which was a standard therapy at the time. This treatment program lasted for 2 years.
When the treatment program ended, Dr. Tolliver Clark, the head of the Public Health Service, wished to continue with studies of syphilis, so he began a non-therapeutic human experiment called the Study of Untreated Syphilis in the Negro Male. He envisioned a 6 to 8 month observational study of untreated latent syphilis, followed by a treatment program.
Syphilis is a sexually transmitted disease that, when untreated, appears in 4 stages: Stage 1 and 2 are characterized by rashes. The third stage is without symptoms and is called latent. The final stage is tertiary syphilis, which can cause severe injury to the heart, brain, and nerves, resulting in paralysis, blindness, or even death. The problems can appear any number of years after the patient is infected. The Tuskegee study focused on men who had latent and tertiary syphilis, and in 1930, no effective cure was known for syphilis.
The study was approved in 1932 by Alabama health officials under the condition that some sort of treatment would ultimately be provided. Clark teamed up with the Tuskegee Institute, a local black university. Raymond A. Vulture-LaHare, a physician who had worked on the earlier treatment program, began to recruit men. Essential to convincing the men was Eunice Rivers, an African-American nurse who accompanied Dr. Vulture-LaHare as he traveled throughout the county. Field stations were created and hundreds were tested. To fulfill the treatment requirements, mercury rubs, injections, and pills were administered. The decision was made to add spinal taps to the study, an extremely painful procedure that provided no benefit to the men. It was performed purely for the sake of science. To encourage participation, a deceiving letter was sent to the subjects claiming, "This is your last chance for special free treatment." For the first time, the rights of the patients were clearly violated as the physicians lied to the patients. By the end of the first year, hundreds of men had been studied. Dr. Clark believed the experiment to be successfully completed and retired. Dr. Vulture-LaHare took over and proposed an ambitious 10-year study of 400 men with autopsies at their deaths to discover syphilis-induced damage on untreated men. To entice participants, he provided a sham treatment of aspirins and mercury compound. In reality, the study visits were conducted simply to confirm the men were still untreated. In 1933, they recruited 384 more men. Ironically, it was African-American Nurse Rivers who held this study together. Since the men trusted her, she could persuade them to sign autopsy agreements. In 1936, the first report was published and the study was continued. Subjects remained uninformed to the study goals. Many didn't even know they had syphilis, as Southern doctors used the term bad blood for many diseases. In addition, they thought they were receiving special free care. In 1943, Dr. John Heller took over the study. This same year, penicillin was proven effective in the treatment of early syphilis. 1948 marked the end of the Nuremberg trials of Nazi doctors involved in concentration camp experiments. The resulting Nuremberg Code was the first real set of rules for ethical medical research.
The thing that amazes me most about the Nuremberg Code is that it was totally ignored by Americans. I think we thought we could never do an ethical research like the Nazis. And yet, at the very same time as the Nazis, and for 30 years after that, we did unethical research without consent on vulnerable minorities. It is without a doubt the Tuskegee doctors broke two bedrock principles of the Nuremberg Code that are medical ethics principles today. You must have consent. The risks of the trial must be proportional to the benefits. Tuskegee doctors violated both.
Ms. Connie St. Clair is a research nurse at National Jewish Health who conducts trials and medications for the treatment of cystic fibrosis.
Before any patient can participate in a clinical trial, they must fully understand all aspects of the study and give informed consent. Some of the important parts of informed consent are that patients understand that they have the choice not to participate in a clinical trial. It is the doctor's ultimate responsibility that the patient fully understand what benefits, if any, they may receive from the study and what risks may be encountered.
The research coordinator verifies the patient truly understands the study. Hospitals and universities can lose all research funding if they fail to monitor their clinical trials. 1957 was the 25th year of the study, and 11 reports have been published. Each man received a certificate of participation and a dollar for every year of service. Meanwhile, views of racism were changing. In 1954, Brown v. Board of Education banned school segregation, and the civil rights movement was growing. Outsiders began to question the study, and some of the men moved from Macon County and sought out penicillin as treatment. The Public Health Service decided to continue on, adding free hot meals and cash payments to the aspirin and iron tonics. Their answers to the racial issues was that advanced syphilis may not respond to treatment.
In 1966, Peter Buxton who was working for the Public Health Service, found out from one of his colleagues that they were doing a study in Tuskegee and denying African-American males treatment for syphilis. He was outraged. He immediately went to some of the top personnel in the Centers for Disease Control and was totally rebuffed. He tried for years to get this through to them, and finally they just told him to stop pursuing this angle because the study was crucial for science and it would help future doctors treat syphilis.
In July 1972, he finally persuaded Associated Press reporter Gene Heller to break the story. It was titled Syphilis Victims in U.S. Study Went Untreated for 40 Years and began with the sentence, "For 40 years, the USPHS has conducted a study in which human beings with syphilis were induced to serve as guinea pigs." The next month, a mixed-race panel created by the Department of Health, Education, and Welfare declared the study ethically unjustified. They found that the doctors denied the rights of the patients by not providing informed consent. The study fell below adequate scientific standards, and treatment should have been provided when penicillin was invented. Remarkably, the Center for Disease Control continued to debate whether or not it was their duty to provide treatment to the men. In March 1973, Senator Ted Kennedy forced them to offer free treatment. By this point, the men had been alerted of the study flaws and hired civil rights lawyer Fred Gray. Gray opposed further free government treatment, fearing this would damage their case for compensation. Plus, most of the men no longer trusted the government to protect their health. Gray filed suit in July 1973, asking for $3 million for each man or his heirs. He focused both on presenting the case in court and again to the public eye. However, Gray protected the African-American doctors, Nurse Rivers, and the Tuskegee Institute by asserting they were also victims. The study began in a time of extreme racism and discrimination, and they were powerless to stopping the study. The case ended in 1974 with a settlement. Surviving men were entitled to $37,500, and the heirs of deceased patients received $15,000. All survivors and some of the families would also get continued free medical treatment. Hearings led by Senator Kennedy in response to the Tuskegee study resulted in the National Commission for the Protection of Human Subjects in Biomedical and Behavioral Research.
The commission created the Belmont Code, which summarizes the rights of the patient and the responsibility of the doctors. The Tuskegee study violated many principles of the Belmont Code, including informed consent of the patient, withholding treatment, putting men and their families at risk, flat-out deception, and the exploitation of a vulnerable group.
As a result of the Tuskegee study, the ethics in medical research was changed forever. The formal apology by President Clinton was a final closing to many decades of pain, injustice, and deception. All study participants are now dead, but the Tuskegee study is likely the most important clinical trial of the 20th century as it redefined the responsibility of doctors to respect and uphold the rights of the patient.
We're back. So you can see this is something that happened for 40 years. It lasted for 40 years from 1932 till 1972. It's on the U.S. soil. So it is something quite shocking in from today's perspective, but it happened. It's something for us to keep in mind and as we discussed ethics in this course and beyond. Before I forget, we have a question of the day. And the question of the day is, why is ethics so important in health and healthcare? So you can, as we have done before, you can call in or you can write in your answer to this question of the day. So next we'll see another short clip about from the medical ethics perspective to look at Tuskegee syphilis trial. So we'll see how that doctor who is MD and PhD talk about this case.
One of the important aspects of the Tuskegee syphilis experiment was the role it played in transforming regulations in the United States regarding research on human subjects. It was a study that a lot of us, a lot of people believed was morally reprehensible. It came to light and thus some changes, in my view, important progressive changes were made. Now, the study itself has a long history. It began by the Public Health Service, a U.S. government agency in the early 30s, and was ended, believe it or not, not until the early 1970s. And the study was actually quite simple. It was a study of the natural progression of syphilis, a venereal disease that, if left untreated, has some really nasty consequences. It can kill you painfully. And in these, in this study, there were subjects who were followed but not given treatment that was known to be effective. This happened over decades' time. Not only that, not surprisingly, these subjects never gave their informed consent to participate in this study. They didn't know what was really going on. And the participants were all African Americans from a poor socioeconomic group from Alabama. Tuskegee was the county seat where the study took place, thus the name.
Welcome back. So you can see this professor from the University of Maryland talking about the medical ethics involved in this Tuskegee syphilis study. And two things, as repeated in the previous video as well, is consent, or better saying, informed consent. So I'm agreeing to something, but I know what I'm agreeing to. So it's not giving a consent as giving consent, but giving consent to something that I know what I'm consenting to. So secondly is treatment. So both aspects were missing in this 40-year-long study. So phrases. One is called venereal disease. That's an older term for sexually transmitted disease. So now we call STD. In the old days, called VD, venereal disease. And the other one is called subject. In this day and age, we call it research participant. So subject is like someone who must subject to the research study. But nowadays we say it's more, we're talking about equality, is that the researchers and the research participants. So two historical terms that we may still hear off and on, but today we call STD, and then syphilis is one of the STDs. And then whoever joins a clinical trial or other research studies, it's called, if it's a human person, then it's called research participant. So that's something we have. And another thing that happened almost in the middle of the Tuskegee study, a woman, also African-American, by the name of Henrietta Lacks, L-A-C-K-S. She was born in Virginia. And she, I think when the study took place, it was in Baltimore. And she's also called the unwitting mother of modern medicine in the US. So Henrietta Lacks, L-A-C-K-S, you guys can look her up. And just Henrietta, the first two letters is H-E, and Lacks, the first two letters are L-A, it's called HeLa, H-E-L-A. So the HeLa cell, she was suffering a cancerous tumor in her late 20s. So the doctors, without giving her clear consent, that's why she's called the unwitting participant. And just they extracted the cancerous tumor cells from her, Henrietta Lacks, and to cultivate. So even though she passed away in, let me see, she passed away, I believe, in 1951. At the age of 29, but her cells kind of live on. So that's why she is called the unwitting mother of modern medicine, especially for cancer research and studies. So this is something that has happened in the US history and around the world. During the Second World War especially, that lots of human atrocities took place. And as far as medical research, we got the Nazi Germany doing horrible things, and also the Imperial Japanese Army doing lots of horrible things. So next, let's watch a short clip about the five most evil things that the Nazi human experiments that carried. So let's watch that video. Thank you. So you just watched a whole bunch of horrible acts by Nazi doctors and scientists at Auschwitz and other concentration camps. So the Nazi doctors and scientists used not everyone, but focusing on the Jews, the Gypsies, or better known now is the Romano people, and also the homosexuals. So as a way of experimenting on these people, they're less privileged and have basically no rights in a society, and they were forced to into those experiments. So that's not the only thing that happened during the Second World War. The Imperial Japanese Army that occupied most of China and other parts of Asia and bombed Pearl Harbor, US territory, and they chose one location in northeast China. It's called Manchuria, and they did the biochemical weapons testing on Chinese citizens during the World War II. And let's roll another tape watching what's happened over there.
The important questions to be asked are these.
So you watched another atrocity done by the Japanese Unit 731 during World War II. It lasted all the way to the end of World War II. And so the US also participated passively by acquiring the quote-unquote research results and giving immunity to the Japanese chief medical officer and some other scientists immunity, which means they were free of any war crime atrocity prosecutions. So of course, you know, this is something that World War II, but you also understand the chemical and biological weapon experiments, the results just lasted into those who survived, lasted into, they say, 60 years, even onto their next generations. Now, that being said, also realize that the U.S. dropped two atomic bombs in Hiroshima and Nagasaki, and the nuclear impact, not killing a lot of people, but the residual impact is just has been tremendous over the decades. So those things, I hope that we learn our lessons from the history. We cannot undo history, we cannot rewrite history, but whatever happened, happened, and hopefully we'll learn from these horrible mistakes that in the past, and we'll avoid making similar or same mistakes in the future. And that's the power of knowing history. And before I move on to something more recent, and I just want to acknowledge somebody is calling in, and thank you for the patience. I don't know your name yet, but okay, so Ruby. Okay, Ruby, so go ahead. Thank you for your patience. Your question, your
okay.
Answer is? Yes.
Yes, my response for the question of the day is health is very important. Ethics is very important in health and healthcare, essentially because all the people should be able to have access to great healthcare. No one should be denied healthcare because of their ethnicity, therefore it would be considered discrimination.
Okay, so you say just health, it is a right that people should have, right? It's not like something
yes.
that certain people will have,
yes.
certain other people may not have. Okay. That's it? Okay, thank you, Ruby. And I just want to acknowledge Shannon, you wrote in, and you're saying that ethics are important in healthcare because many people needing care are either misinformed about treatment or are unable to give consent for medical procedures. For example, if they're in a coma, ethics must ensure that nobody will be taken advantage of. Great job, Shannon. And next we have from Savannah. You wrote, ethics is important in healthcare because although the doctor may be medically correct, they still must respect the patient and their wants or needs. All right, good job. Thank you, Ruby, and thank you, Shannon and Savannah. We have more responses, but I'll save for later. Okay, now we talked about something more remote in history for us, and we also wish to look at something that's more recent, is that what happened about exactly 3 years ago in California, in Bakersfield. It is something that happened in not nursing home, not assisted living, but related to, it's called independent living for older adults. And there's a nurse that's, she's a nurse, she knows how to perform CPR, but she refused to, she called 911, and there are some ethical issues involved in that case. So let's look at what happened.
Well, we're following a shocking case in California, a retirement home now defending a nurse who refused to perform CPR on an 87-year-old woman who collapsed and stopped breathing. Here's the 911 call where you can hear the operator frantically pleading with the nurse to save the woman's life.
We need to get CPR started. That's not enough. Okay.
We can't do CPR.
Okay, then hand down the phone to the passerby. Anybody there can do CPR. Give them the phone, please. I understand if your facility is not willing to do that, give the phone to that passerby, that stranger that has it done. This woman's not breathing enough. She's going to die if we don't get this started.
I don't know where he is, but she's yelling at me and saying that we have to have one of our other residents perform CPR. I'm so instructed, and I'm not going to do that.
You're going to let this lady die?
Well, that's why we're calling 911.
We can't wait.
He's saying we don't, so you can talk to my boss, and I'm...
Okay.
I don't know.
They're refusing CPR. They're going to let her die. Yes, a human being. I don't, you know, is there anybody that's willing to help this lady and not let her die?
Phone call, right? How could this happen? What recourse does this woman's family have? There's a nurse that's not providing CPR, and she's dying there on the phone, on the floor. Let's get our legal panel in on this. Brian Silber is a trial attorney and defense attorney. Chip Merlin, also a trial attorney as well. So Brian, is the nursing home liable for this death?
Well, we have to see what the evidence tells us. You know, first of all, let me say, on a personal note, I think the way this nurse conducted herself is morally reprehensible. That said, we now have a question of law, and when I analyze this case, I see two overwhelming issues. Number one, what is the cause of death? In other words, did the failure to deliver CPR actually cause or contribute to this woman's death? And the thing that comes to my mind is, what if she had this massive brain aneurysm that caused her to bleed out internally, where CPR wouldn't have made any difference?
But they didn't try anything, though, Chip. I mean, they didn't do anything. They just let her lay there on the ground, and they said, we have to wait for the ambulance.
If you listen to the tape very carefully, they even refused to go get somebody who would volunteer that could help out and possibly get the CPR that could have saved the person.
The 911 operator
anybody.
Was like, get somebody, a stranger anybody. Off the street, and have them give them the phone and have them do CPR. And they wouldn't do it.
The 911 operators are trained that if somebody's not willing to do it, to ask for another volunteer. And indeed, we have Good Samaritan laws throughout the states to protect rescuers who come and volunteer to follow these procedures, to give the compression to the person who's in the emergency, and they have those laws in California.
Okay, wait.
They have them in California, even for nurses.
Brian, you say that doesn't apply here?
That's correct. You need to look at California Health and Safety Code 1799.102, which explicitly takes out anybody who's given compensation from the Good Samaritan protection. And as an independent living facility with a paid nurse on staff, they get compensation. So they would not be protected by the Good Samaritan law. So you're saying that this nurse
wouldn't be protected under that law if something went wrong when she was trying to aid this woman, and that's why potentially this place where she's employed will not allow her to do that.
Sadly, that's my suspicion, and I believe that this company saw itself stuck between being an independent living facility, which is basically a retirement home. These people aren't patients. And then, of course, having the issue of what if, what do we do? So they put it on 911.
Okay,
Call for the professionals to come and help.
Chip, let me read to you their statement, because they do have a statement, Glenwood Gardens, that talks a little bit about their policy. They say this: in the event of a health emergency at this independent living community, our practice is to immediately call emergency medical personnel for assistance and to wait with the individual needing attention until such personnel arrives. That is the protocol we followed. Chip, you had something interesting in your notes, though. You say that there is a fine print that we should all know about if we're having a relative at a facility like this. What is it?
In their advertising, if you look at it, they advertise that they have trained, caring staff available, and anytime they need assistance by request or otherwise, that they will get it right away. That's in the advertising. Yet when the senior citizens come there, and the small contract, it's sort of a bait and switch. And what they do is they have them sign a contract saying, if you're an independent living facility, we're not going to provide anything. They advertise and promise one thing, but then when they have them sign the small print, it's another. That's what they're relying upon in this particular case.
Brian, and to Chip's point, should they not have a nurse on staff then? Is that where there's a big problem here? Because if it was a receptionist calling in and saying, listen, I can't do CPR, would this be a different story?
Well, essentially what they're saying is, you know, I think Chip is taking it out of context respectfully. You know, they have a person who's present who can facilitate the getting of help that's necessary, kind of like a fire alarm that calls the fire department or a burglar alarm that might call for the police. They have a nurse on staff that says, uh-oh, such and such happened, let's go get medical assistance. And I think they are living up to that end of their advertising.
Chip, final thought here. The daughter of this woman is a nurse and has publicly said she doesn't have any problem with the care that her mother received. So at this point, is it over? Is that just it? This woman died and there was no one to help her?
The wrongful death statutes, you know, only provided back to the surviving individuals to bring the action. So if there is no lawsuit, there's no lawsuit. But it doesn't mean that people should not go back and look at this particular case. This is an important situation. People need to know that they can go and volunteer and help out and not worry about getting sued. Do the moral thing. Do the right thing. Save somebody. At least give them the chance.
It's a good way to end it there, Chip.
Okay. Thanks for watching. And then you look at this case just happened about 3 years ago in March 2013. And so two lawyers, trial lawyers, discussing the case from two different perspectives. It ended up with there was no case, there was no lawsuit, because the woman, the 87-year-old woman, had this called DNR on her file. It's called the Do Not Resuscitate in case there is a stroke or there is a heart attack. So that's what happened. And her daughter, who's also a nurse, and basically said that she would not file a wrongful death lawsuit. But certainly the case lingers. And it is, if you Google it, you will find a lot of comments and opinions based on this case. So this is involving in ethical decisions. And the nurse who was on staff and who called 911 basically was afraid of losing her job because she's not supposed to perform CPR, even though she knew how to perform CPR. So you can see the touchy-feely parts of this case. So something else that also happened, now that was a case happened in Bakersfield. And about the same year, there was a young girl, 13 years old. She had her tonsils removed and she went into a coma and she fell into a vegetative state and was pronounced brain dead. So her name is Jahai McMath, M-C-M-A-T-H, Jahai, J-A-H-I, so Jahai McMath. And she's also a case that has brought national attention, not only in California, but national attention, is whether the right to die or the right to live. So that is something. And earlier, in year 2005, another person who was in vegetative state for 15 years, from 1990 to 2005, her name was Terry Schiavo, and also brought national attention to this right to die or right to live argument. Nevertheless, that's being said, last October, early October 2015, California's Governor Jerry Brown signed into law, state law, and saying that physician-assisted suicide now becomes legal in California. And that is something that has brought national attention. So California now is the fifth state in the union allowing physician-assisted suicide. And other states are also, Oregon started 20 years before, but California is number five and also the largest state in the union joining this movement. Ethicists, medical professionals, all have their different opinions. And many of my physician friends, they are not comfortable dealing with it. And then you can see there's no clear cut. What if family members, someone who might be dying, and then also a medical, other healthcare professionals encounter such a problem, and we got something to discuss and just look at what the governor says when he announces that he signs into law this physician-assisted suicide act in the state of California. So let's take a look.
It's an issue that California has wrestled with for decades. 20 years after the state of Oregon passed the nation's first assisted suicide law, America's most populous state has followed suit. The End of Life Option Act will allow doctors to prescribe life-ending drugs to people diagnosed as having less than 6 months to live. The governor of California, Jerry Brown, gave his approval to the law after apparently agonizing over his decision. The 77-year-old Democrat, who studied as a young man to enter the priesthood, said he consulted widely. As well as listening to the views of his own doctors and a Catholic bishop, the governor says he considered input from the family of Brittany Maynard. The 29-year-old cancer patient moved from California to Oregon to take her own life last year. She was a vocal campaigner for the right to death with dignity. The bill's passing marks the end of a long and emotional debate in California.
For every individual that feels they will be helped by this, there are 10 or 100 or maybe more, maybe 1,000 people who could be significantly harmed through abuse, through coercion, and through medical error.
Governor Brown said he'd reflected on what he would want in the face of his own death. He concluded that it would be a comfort to consider the options afforded by the bill and that he would not deny that right to others. Peter Bowes, BBC News, Los Angeles.
Earlier, I spoke to Zoe Fitzgerald Carter, whose mother took her life 14 years ago following a 20-year battle with Parkinson's disease. She told me that under previous law, people have faced the legal system for helping someone to die.
Well, there have been cases with people who have assisted parents with their death who have actually gone to jail. Oftentimes, I think these things happen in the shadows, the way they did with my mother. People don't necessarily involve doctors. They take the situation into their own hands, and it's often very stressful, and sometimes it can be a terrible, violent ending. I think we've all read about those cases. So I'm very pleased with the decision today.
Had your mother spoken to her doctors about how possibly she could best end her life in a way that she wanted to?
She did speak with her doctor, and he was a very lovely, well-trusted man, and he made it very clear that he could not help her legally to end her life. And it really left her on her own, and it left her family, which is her daughters, including myself, to really try and figure things out with her without any medical supervision. And it was very stressful.
Do you think that even now, despite this law, some doctors in California may feel that it goes against their own ethics to actually help a patient die in their own home, effectively commit suicide, kill themselves, end their life?
I'm sure that there are those doctors, and I don't think those doctors should have to prescribe those medications if they are morally opposed, just as there are doctors who do not perform abortions if they don't believe in them. I think most doctors consider it part of what they do, and if they're helping patients who are dying anyway to end in a more compassionate, quicker way, I can't imagine a doctor in good faith turning that patient away.
So it's the fifth American state now, California. Do you think eventually it will become a law in all of the United States? Will California be setting a precedent even more than those other four states to have the same law?
I think that California is a very is a real leader in the states, and I think what we do here has a lot of impact. We're a big state, we're a powerful state. I think it's very significant that we've passed this law, and there are something like 50% of the other states in this country have laws like this in the wings, and I'm just hoping that California will move some of those people to pass similar laws. I don't know if it will ever be true in every state in the United States. We certainly have a long way to go to get to that place.
Marilyn Golden there, the policy analyst who is in Peter Bowes' report, said that there could be quite a few people who will be victims of abuse of this new law. You kind of think that possibly terminally ill patients, some analysts are saying, that they could have pressure put upon them to take this course of action when actually they may personally not feel it's completely correct, but there's pressure from possibly other members of the family who are having to take care of terminally ill people.
You know, I just don't see that. And there are obviously dysfunctional families, and look, sometimes people, you know, commit homicides in those sorts of situations, and those people would be held responsible by the law. But I don't think most people pressure their loved aged relatives to kill themselves. I just don't believe that. And I'm sure it will happen here and there. You know, humanity is what it is. But I think those are such the exceptions to the rule. And I think it's kind of scaremongering technique to keep repeating that. I don't think it's the common scenario. I just don't.
So you can see it's a very complex issue. Right to die or right to live. And then you can see their advocates, their opponents, and both sides have strong points. So this is for us not taking sides, but rather developing critical thinking skills. Look at all facts, opinions, and then make up your own mind. And also you may find more information, you may develop new insight down the road, and you may change your mind as a result. So that's something that with that in mind, we'll take a break. And also when we come back, we have a few of you having responses to the question of the day. So let's take a break now.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
To be congratulated on undertaking a sometimes difficult but always rewarding task of earning your college education. You are here and you are in for a great ride. Want to be successful.
Learn more and you will succeed and excel.
Go Toros!
You can be the class of 2018 that changed the world.
You can do that because you're at CSU Dominguez Hills.
At Dominguez Hills, we want you to get better.
Are in control of your destiny.
Do well, go Toros.
I'm Bill DeLuca, and we have a unique theater company on our campus at Cal State Dominguez, and it's called Teatro Dominguez. So what we've been doing for almost 25 years here with Teatro is putting together shows that are basically folk tales that are maybe a half hour long and performed in local schools.
Bill and I first started with this idea of what did we want to say. We wanted to talk about conservation. We talked about what are some animals in these areas that are, number one, possibly endangered because of pollution.
The admiration is stupendous.
This program is unique in that we get to talk to kids about really important things and the impact that you make, and you feel it immediately. It's right there. And you walk away going, I did something good today.
Hello, my name is Lyra Harding. I'm a junior at California State University, Dominguez Hills. The reason why I chose this university was for small classes and interactive programs.
Enrich your life. Increase your earning potential. Cal State Dominguez Hills offers a master's degree in the humanities. With a focus on the cities of the world, this master's degree can be earned in as little as 5 semesters. Evening classes are available for your convenience. Why wait? Call 310-243-3636. That's 310-243-3636.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Welcome back. And before we move on to the second half, which will talk more about the definition, ethics, and other more theoretical stuff, I just want to acknowledge some responses to question of the day. And first one's from Rachel. And Rachel, you wrote, ethics is important in healthcare because the patient needs to know what's happening. The patient needs to know what they are allowed, what they are allowing the medical professionals to do. They also need to consent to it once they know what will be happening. Today we sign contracts so there is proof that patient consented. So something, a written proof, in something in writing, that's good. And next is from Ian. And you wrote, I believe that ethics is important in healthcare because things can easily get out of hand. As in the first video, the treatment of the man with syphilis was inhumane. We need to have guidelines to make sure that people are treated fairly and justly and not used as science experiments. So probably as guinea pigs, as we may commonly say. So good job. And we have more, and we'll wait till we move on a little bit further into the second half of the lessons. And first one is just look at what is ethics. So what is the definition of ethics? So in the textbook on page 140, we do have the definition. It says ethics. So ethics is the study of, here says, well, the three major areas of philosophy. We talked about philosophy and theory last two classes. And the other one here says that ethics is the study of morality. And ethics is also called moral philosophy. So the two kind of sister parts of philosophy, the other one is, other than ethics, we have something called epistemology and metaphysics. And one is epistemology is the study of knowledge, and the metaphysics is the study of the nature of reality. So this is something that we talk about. So it is ethics. So let's look at a fellow professor's definition of ethics in a very humorous way. So let's see what he says.
So what is ethics? Well, now we could get into a detailed philosophical analysis here, which I absolutely do not want to do. There are 100 libraries of books written about this, most of them which are unbelievably boring. I want to suggest a stipulative definition, that is a definition that says, this is the way I'm going to use it. And I use it because, and suggest it because, this is comes out of my understanding of what's a skillful way to look at this for our own lives, for our own ethics and our own growth and well-being, not to mention the well-being of others. And I want to suggest that the key factor in ethics is the intention that underlies our behavior, the intention or motivation driving behavior. This is not a new idea. 1500 years ago, Muhammad said, all actions are judged by the motives prompting them. Okay. So I want to suggest that when we look at ethics, what we really want to zero in on is the intention with which we're acting. And I want to suggest that an intention is ethical to the extent it aims at enhancing the welfare and well-being of everyone, including oneself. Okay. Now the last bit, including oneself, is very important, because if you don't have that last bit, then the attempt to be ethical ends up as self-sacrifice. And that belief is one of the pervasive distortions in our culture about the very nature of ethics. Our culture, for the most part, believes that ethics is self-sacrifice. You do ethics, you be ethical because it's the right thing to do, or because God will get you, or some such. Okay. And this is a tragic misunderstanding, because properly understood, ethics is not self-sacrificed, but enlightened and enlightening self-interest. Okay?
Welcome back. So you can see and hear Professor Rogers' definition of ethics. And he's quite humorous. So he basically said it's more about intention and motivation. So if it's intended to do good to the well-being and the welfare of self and people around and maybe the entire humanity, if somebody is in the leadership position, and that's good, that's ethical. So it's a kind of a working definition and also a pragmatic description of what ethics should be and is intended to. So that's something quite good. Before we watch, some of you might be aspire to become a medical doctor, a nurse, or other healthcare professionals. Some of your parents might be intending you to becoming one. So we'll see a clip on Grey's Anatomy. But before that, I want to acknowledge some of the responses to the question of the day, which is, in case we have forgotten, is why is ethics so important in health and healthcare? Here I have Jacqueline's response. Ethics is important in every aspect of life because I believe that it's what separates us from being animals or monsters. But ethics in health is more important by a tenfold because when it comes to health, someone is their faith, trust, hope, and ultimately life in that doctor or person's hands. And to have that trust completely violates by disregarding normal ethics can be dooming for everyone involved. Okay, some good points that, you know, it's buying a car is one experience. Being treated by a doctor when someone's ill, it could be a little bit different because buying a car or shopping for a car, if I don't like it, I can walk off at any time. But when I'm ill, I may not be able to walk away by myself. So I'm in a more vulnerable and compromising position and a state of mind or state of physical well-being. So yes, ethics seemingly more important. Thank you. Next, I have Pilar's. And Pilar, you wrote, ethics is such an important part of health and healthcare because it allows for humans to be treated with humanity. Ethics means that people and patients are going to be treated respectfully and humanely. Unethical healthcare systems will result in situations similar to the syphilis case and other inhumane scientific experimentation on people during World War II, where they are taken advantage of. All right, good point, Pilar. So next, we'll just look at, we have more responses. We'll wait for a moment. So next, look at this. Now, this is not real. It's fictional, but it's a popular TV show called Grey's Anatomy. So now look at what is the doctors and other healthcare professionals are encountered by the patients with their life and death situations and how they debate and think about and critically think about ethical approaches. So let's roll that video clip.
Bad?
Traffic violation. What's wrong with you, kid?
I need a new liver and a new intestine.
Yeah? You want mine?
Man's organs. He offered.
You know how in school the rules you have to follow? The same goes for here. We have to follow the rules or else we get in big trouble. And what that man offered you was definitely against the rules.
No. She's fighting with the insurance people again.
You're not supposed to worry about stuff like that.
No. Tell her something good today. Even if nothing good happens. She needs good news.
I've got a body full of high-quality parts here. 3-day liquidation sale. Everything must go.
Even if we could do it, you have to be a match for him. Which means we'd have to cross-match your blood with his.
Good thing we're both in a hospital, then.
A boy who needs organs, I presume, wants to live. organs. I'm ready to die.
We've removed a piece of your skull, which means your brain is now only covered by dura mater. It's virtually exposed. If somehow that area were to be damaged, it would cause intracranial bleeding, which would cause your brain to swell worse than it did today, which would result in brain death. So as your doctor, I need you to be very careful not to damage it. Do you understand what I'm saying?
So you can see it's quite dramatic. Of course, it's fictitious, it's a drama. And you can see a Hippocratic oath was mentioned, and the doctor basically said the oath probably doesn't apply at that moment, and she seemed quite emotional. And you can see it's not a clear cut. When we say ethics, we can describe our ethics, but in critical moments, sometimes it becomes more challenged, more convoluted, so to speak. So that's a tough call. All right, so I want to acknowledge some of the responses. So you put in, I have Joshua. And Joshua, you put down, ethics are important in healthcare because it guarantees that everyone gets equal care. and protects patients from unwanted medical procedures and acts. The ethics of health are essentially guidelines that doctors must follow to ensure the best care for patients. Therefore, it is very important. Thank you, Joshua. Next, we have Sage. And Sage, you wrote, sorry if you have already answered this, but what is ethics and ethic health? At the moment, I am having trouble finding out what it means. So that's an honest answer. And then sometimes we don't know exactly what that means. So that's the beauty of ethics. It's the study of morality. So what is morality? That could be, we kind of know the area, but we may not be able to pinpoint what exactly ethics are or ethics is or morality is. So that is something for us to reflect on and to kind of think about over time and as we are getting older and getting more knowledgeable. Okay. So we have one more response, which I will save till later. And so after that, we want to go take a look at, so we talked about ethics, that's on page 140. And on page 141, if you have a textbook in front of you, we have something called professional ethics. So you can see Grey's Anatomy that talked about, you know, how doctors behave and how they make tough decisions. And many times it can be very tough. And they can make a mistake here and there. And the other one is called the research ethics. So you can reflect on the first half of this afternoon is what happened in Alabama, what happened in Nazi Germany, what happened in Manchuria in China. So that those are research experiments. So how things should be done and how the research participants be treated and they need to have informed consent. And also the researchers also need to provide available treatments. As sometimes you may see on TV, you hear on radio ads about clinical trials. So those two elements must be obeyed, informed consent and possible treatment. So that's something I think we have a better knowledge after today's lesson. Further down, it's on page 149, we have context of ethical decision making. So this is, it's on page 149 in the middle, is a context of ethical decision making. So we have a number of things. It's a place, time, identity, social relationships, the ideal, the concrete, and the seriousness. So a bunch of things that's like just will facilitate our decision making ethically. So this is something that for us to see. So place is be aware of the appropriateness of an action in a particular environment. So whether, you know, buying a car, that's a car dealership maybe, or a used car dealership or a new car dealership. And then for some medical treatment, it will be in a clinic or in a hospital setting. So one action may be appropriate in one setting, but not in another. So this is more the location, the place. Next one is time. So be aware of the history leading up to the decision and other similar decisions. Learn from past decisions. So the first half of today's lecture, I showed you something that may not sit comfortable with you, and that's what's intended. It's something that for us to realize that those very erroneous, very atrocious decisions made in the past should not be repeated. And the humanity must learn a lesson from those horrible periods of time and horrible acts against humanity. Next one is identity. Who am I? How does this moral decision relate to me? So as a student, you may not have a lot of critical moments that you need to make an ethical decision. But maybe as simple as academic honesty, something that you may wish to think about, I'd rather do something honestly and ethically versus do something otherwise. Next one is social relationships. Here says, be aware of that making moral decisions will impact social relationships. There is a good chance that not everyone will agree with your decision and action. So something that you make sometimes to make a tough call. See like two lawyers debating over this 87-year-old woman died without having CPR performed on her. And just they kind of lashed out on each other and also on the facility and also the nurse who refused to perform, rather calling 911. And just like even though the at the end there's no nasty lawsuit, but just so you look at the two different sides that could decent people, experienced trial lawyers may reach to reach different conclusions. So sometimes a tough decision, an ethical decision, could make you potentially lose friendship. And that's something that teenagers and young adults may take very seriously. But you should have more friends or you should act more ethically. That's the debate. Next one is the ideal. Number five, when making a moral decision, aim for the most noble ideals of humanity. So I think that's self-explanatory. Next one is the concrete. Never lose sight of the fact that choices arise from concrete events. So it is something that we want to say it's hard facts, concrete, the concrete. So it's not like something maybe more fluid, more convoluted. And last one is seriousness. When making a moral decision, do so with an attitude that it is appropriate to the situation. So this is something that, be serious about the decision. It's not something I decide one way and tomorrow I come back with a different opinion. Just kind of stick to it. So something else, just saying like initially what ethics is, back on page 140, it says that initially that, let me see, we have the Greek philosopher Socrates. And he lived between 470 to 399 BC, and who spent his days in Athenian marketplace challenging people to think about how they lived. So this is something about Socrates, that he walked around the marketplace and challenging people, say how you should behave more ethically. So hopefully we have some healthy environment amongst us, is that we will be able to kind of help each other to become better persons, more ethical persons. So we'll eventually have more ethical communities and a better society, better nation, and better world. So that is something that we need to work on ethically, and then just working on the ethical behaviors of ourselves and people surrounding us. So, and last topic I want to cover in today's lecture about ethics in health and healthcare is something called HIPAA, which stands for, it's HIPAA, stands for called Health Insurance Portability and Accountability Act. So that's what stands for, called HIPAA. And we'll just take a short, we'll take a look at a short video about what HIPAA is. So this is something, and also we'll, the next one, we'll look at what some HIPAA mistakes are. So let's see the video.
A hospital in Michigan accidentally posts the medical records of thousands of patients on the internet. A health insurer loses the financial, health, and personal information of 450,000 customers and fails to notify them for 6 months. And two of the largest pharmacy chains in the U.S. are found discarding patient records and other legally protected information in unsecured dumpsters. This unnecessary exposure of private information should be alarming. In fact, since the creation of the HIPAA Act, the Department of Health and Human Services has investigated approximately 8,000 legitimate complaints of privacy violations. These statistics are simply unacceptable. As professionals who work in healthcare, how we protect personal health information is just as much a part of our jobs as the care we deliver. At stake is not only the privacy of the individual's care, but the security of personal information, which could be used for medical identity theft and other illegal purposes. And as healthcare continues to adopt technology to coordinate patient care, such as electronic health records and computerized physician order entry, the need to protect electronic health information is becoming more and more important. In 2003, the Department of Health and Human Services began enforcing the Health Insurance Portability and Accountability Act, or HIPAA. Essentially, the HIPAA law protects the security and privacy of all medical records and other health information that is used or shared in any form, and protects patients' rights by giving them access to their health information and control over how it is used. In 2009, as part of the American Recovery and Reinvestment Act, also known as the Stimulus Bill, even more changes were made to the HIPAA privacy and security standards, including requirements for addressing breaches. There are certain businesses called covered entities that must follow the HIPAA rule. These include entities that provide or bill for medical care and services, such as hospitals, skilled nursing facilities, home health agencies, ambulatory surgery centers, and physician offices. Entities that pay for medical care or process health information in order to conduct financial and administrative transactions, such as a health plan, healthcare clearinghouse, or a claims processing or billing company, and their business associates, such as third-party administrators. HIPAA is a federal law, so compliance is not voluntary, it's mandatory. And ignorance of the law is no defense. As an employee of a healthcare facility, you must become aware of your role in protecting the privacy and security of your patient's health information, or subject yourself and your facility to dire consequences. Anyone that obtains or discloses protected health information for personal or commercial gain, for malicious purposes, or by willful neglect is subject to termination, suspension, and criminal and civil penalties, including jail time and fines ranging from $100 to $50,000 per violation. Before we can explain the HIPAA privacy and security standards and how we are expected to follow them, it's important to understand some basic definitions. HIPAA is specifically concerned with protected health information, or PHI, which is defined as information that relates to the health of an individual, the health care provided to that individual, or payment for health care provided. PHI is protected whether it is spoken, electronic, or written. PHI includes information that can be used directly or indirectly to identify an individual, such as name, address, birth date, social security number, or medical record number. The bottom line is that any information that relates to a patient's health cannot be disclosed or shared unless authorized either by the patient or someone acting on the patient's behalf, or unless permitted by HIPAA regulation. Additionally, the facility must limit access to only those individuals who need the information for a legitimate purpose. For example, an insurance company may need to access private information in order to pay a claim, but they cannot share this information with the patient's employer. The doctors or nurses in a hospital who are involved in the direct care of a patient need complete access to all the medical records of a patient in order to provide the best care possible. But a lab worker processing the patient's tests would not need full access, since this information is not vital to evaluating the tests. This nurse used her position to access a co-worker's health record and is gossiping about the results. Since this nurse is using private medical information for personal and malicious purposes, she is in clear violation of HIPAA regulations. The nurse could be suspended or terminated by the hospital.
So you can see HIPAA is something serious, but it is also probably for most of you, if not all, like you're probably hearing HIPAA for the first time. But it is something that's been around initially proposed in 1996, so it's been 20 years. The implementation has been shorter than that, but it's more about ensuring patients' rights and privacy. In this digital age, like we have a lot of electronic records, and the things could be compromised quite easily. So it's something that, you know, healthcare professionals must really take very seriously. Before I show you the last one, which is about HIPAA violations, I just want to acknowledge the last two responses to today's question of the day. First one's from Alexis, and you wrote, ethics is a set of moral principles, beliefs, and values that guide us in making choices about medical care. Ethical aspects of healthcare decisions help us make choices that are right, good, fair, and just. And next we have from Sage, and Sage, you wrote, ethics is our sense of right and wrong, and our beliefs about the rights we possess and the duties we owe to others, which helps us think carefully about aspects of health, helping us make choices that are right and good. So some good responses. And lastly, we'll just watch we may not have enough time, just some HIPAA violations that's happening at healthcare settings. So let's watch that part.
Oh my God, Bobby gave me this patient at 378. She's got C. diff, and I can tell she's just gonna run me all day long, and she's gonna be a bad one, I can tell.
Oh no, did you bring your nose plug?
I probably should.
I'm like 388 place on you down the hall.
Oh, I'm sure you will, I'm sure. This is taking forever. Do you wanna take the stairs?
Yeah, let's just go take the stairs.
Okay.
Oh my God.
Yeah.
What are their names now? I'm calling the hospital administrator. I can't believe they're talking about my mom in front of me. What was her name?
I think Tess.
Did you get the other one? I can't believe they were talking about that in the hallway.
Okay, so this is something that we have to cut it short, and it's just like the health providers, I think they're nursing aides, they were gossiping about certain patient and just went on further, just like these are actors, not the real situations, but rather just like sharing patient's information freely in the hallway while actually the patient's daughter, supposedly also an actor, just heard that and got very upset. And another one was talking about just heard what the doctor said and telling the patient, you just have like a few days to live, and I'm very sorry about that. And these are very unprofessional and unethical approaches. So hopefully we learn something about how to behave more ethically, either in healthcare field as a patient, as a professional, or in other NL setting. We have a good afternoon.